Welcome all. This is the first lecture of process heat transfer. This course is being offered by the Department of Chemical, Polymer and Composite Materials Engineering at University of Engineering and Technology, New Campus, Lahore. Let us just talk about the introduction of process heat transfer. In the mode of process heat transfer, practically all the operations that are carried out by the chemical engineer involve the production or the absorption of energy in the form of heat. The laws governing the transfer of heat and the types of operators that have for their main object the control of heat flow are therefore of great importance. This lecture basically deals with the modes of heat transfer and their laws with their applications. Let's just talk about the lecture outline. In this lecture, I'm going to explain about the basics of heat transfer, the first law of thermodynamics, and the mechanism of heat transfer that includes the conduction, convection, and radiation. I'll also explain the one-dimensional heat conduction equation, as well as the steady heat conduction in plane walls, as well as the transient heat conduction. At the end, I'll also explain about the lump system analysis and the transient heat conduction with special effects. Basics of heat transfer. In the basics of heat transfer, actually the heat transfer is the movement of energy from a hot place to a cooler place due to a temperature difference. So we will discuss the three modes of heat transfer. The first one is conduction, second is convection, and the third is radiation. At the start of the lecture, I'll just explain the basics of the conduction, convection, and radiation, and later on I will explain the laws associated with the three modes of heat transfer. Conduction. Heat is transferred by conduction when adjacent atoms vibrate against each other or as electrons move from one atom to another. Conduction is the most significant means of heat transfer within a solid or between solid objects in thermal contact. Let us have an example which is given in front of you. When a pan is being heated from the bottom, the handle of the pan also becomes hot. The handle of the pan becomes hot is due to the vibration of the atoms or the movement of the electrons from one place to another place. This is one of the perfect example of conduction. Convective heat transfer, often referred to simply as convection, is the transfer of heat from one place to another place by the movement of fluids. Convection is usually the dominant form of heat transfer in liquids and gases, and it is also classified as free convection and the forced convection. I'll explain about the free and the forced convection in the subsequent lectures. Here comes the best example of the convection. When you heat the pan having a certain type of liquid, you just heat the pan from the bottom. After certain time, the liquid becomes heated from the bottom, and after a few minutes or after a while, the whole liquid in the pan becomes heated. This is just due to the movement of the liquid molecules in the pan. So the whole liquid becomes hot due to the movement of the fluid molecules. Radiation. Heat transfer by thermal radiation is the transfer of heat by electromagnetic waves. It is different from conduction and convection as it requires no medium or no matter to be present. The radiative energy will pass through vacuum as well as clear air. Here comes the classified example of radiation. When you heat something on a burner, you will also feel the hot area or the radiations at some distance. The hotness you feel at some distance from the heated place is due to the radiations. Thermodynamics and heat transfer. Heat is the form of energy that can be transferred from one system to another as a result of temperature difference, as this statement as I have already explained in the previous slide. The science that deals with the determination of the rates of such energy transfer is called the heat transfer. Here comes the perfect example of heat transfer and the insulations. As you can see on the bottom side, we have the hot coffee cup, which is maintained at a temperature of 70 degrees centigrade. The environment temperature surrounding the coffee cup is 20 degrees centigrade. So here is the temperature gradient. That is, the heat is being transferred from the higher temperature to the lower temperature. So the heat will transfer from 70 degrees centigrade to the 20 degrees centigrade. In the second example, when you have a hot coffee in the thermos bottle, so the thermos bottle has a certain type of insulation that prevents the transfer of heat from a hot source to the cold source. In our daily life, there are many applications of heat transfer. So the air conditioning is one of the best example, the car radiators and the refrigeration systems, the power plants, air circuits. Above all, the human body is a source of heat. So heat is being transferred from a human body to the surrounding. Sometimes the heat is being transferred from surrounding to the human body. So there are several applications, practical applications in our life related to the process heat transfer. Engineering heat transfer. Heat transfer equipments such as heat exchangers, boilers, condensers, radiators, heaters, furnaces, refrigerators, and solar collectors are designed primarily on the basis of heat transfer analysis. Heat transfer problems often encountered in practice can be considered into two groups. The first one is the rating problems. Second one is the sizing problems. The rating problems deals with the determination of heat transfer rate for an existing system at a specified temperature difference, whereas the sizing problems deals with the determination of a size of a system in order to transfer the heat at a specified rate for a specified temperature difference. We will discuss about the rating problems and the sizing problems of heat exchangers in a very detail in our upcoming lectures. From this slide, I'm just going to explain about the three modes of heat transfer. So before going into the details, let's have a look on the basic terminologies related to the heat transfer or the process heat transfer course. First of all, the heat as a form of energy that can be transferred from one system to another system because of the temperature difference. Secondly, the science that deals with the determination of the rates of such energy transfer is called the heat transfer. So at the third place, we can just classify the modes of heat transfer into three ways, that the conduction, convection, and radiation. The one thing that you all need to keep in your mind that all modes of heat transfer requires the existence of temperature difference. If there is temperature difference, then there will be the transfer of heat between two bodies. And if there is no heat temperature difference, then there will be the no heat transfer between two bodies. So all the modes are from the heat is being transferred in all the modes from higher temperature medium to a lower temperature medium. Now let's just focus on the first mode of heat transfer, that is known as conduction. Conduction is the transfer of energy from more energetic particles of a substance to the adjacent less energetic ones as a result of interactions between the particles. So keep in mind that general perception is conduction is always takes place in solids. No. Conductions can take place in solids, liquids, and gases. The classified examples related to the conduction will be given in the upcoming slides. In gases and liquids, conduction is due to the collision and the diffusion of the molecules during their random motion. So in solids, it is due to the combination of vibration of the molecules in the lattice and the energy transport by the free electrons. I think the examples of conduction in the liquids and gases as well as the solid is explained properly. Let us just take an example of the conduction. For example, a cold canned drink in a warm room eventually warms up due to the room temperature as a result of the heat is being transferred from the room to the cold drink through the aluminium coil by the conduction process. Through a large plane wall. Let us take an example that if we have a wall having an area A and the one side of the temperature of the wall is T1, which is the higher temperature. Let us take an example. And the other side of the temperature of the wall is T2 and heat is being transferred from left to right, and the thickness of the wall is delta x. So the rate of heat conduction through a plane layer is proportional to the temperature difference across the layer, number one. Second, the heat transfer area. And the third one is the inversely proportional to the thickness of the layer. So the rate of heat conduction through a plane wall basically depends upon three things. Number one, the area facing the wall. Number two, the temperature difference. Number three, the thickness of the wall. So this statement can be translated into an equation. So rate of heat transfer is directly proportional to the area and the temperature difference, and inversely proportional to the thickness. And it can be translated into an equation in this way. So this proportionality sign can be replaced with the equality sign. Now we have to put some sort of constant. This constant is known as thermal conductivity, and it is always material dependent. Some materials have high thermal conductivity, some materials have low thermal conductivity. Now the question is, what is thermal conductivity? Thermal conductivity is the ability of a material to conduct the heat. The example is, let's take an example, the iron, which is basically has the higher thermal conductivity, whereas the wood, which has less ability to conduct the heat, has the less value of thermal conductivity. The rate of heat conduction through a plane wall, the equation can be written as in this way. This is the rate of heat conduction, Q dot, is equal to minus K, that is the thermal conductivity. A is the perpendicular surface area. Delta T is the temperature difference, and delta X is the thickness of the wall. So this equation can be modified as in this way. If the delta X approaches to zero, what does it mean? It means that if the thickness of the wall is very small, so this delta sign would be replaced with the differential sign. So the above equation can be written as Q dot is equal to minus KA delta T over delta X. This particular equation is simply known as the Fourier's law of heat conduction, and which is basically presented by the J. Fourier in 1822. Now the question is, we have seen that in the previous slide, initially there was no negative sign, but after that there is a negative sign. Now the question is, from where this negative sign comes out? So this negative sign can be explained from this expression. This is delta T over delta X. This is known as temperature gradient. This temperature gradient is basically negative, and it is basically explained here. The delta X, delta T over delta X is the temperature gradient, which is the heat is conducted in the direction of decreasing temperature. You know, this is the higher temperature and this is the lower temperature, and heat is being transferred from the higher temperature to the lower temperature, and the temperature gradient becomes negative when the temperature decreases with increasing X. So X means this side, X is basically increasing, the increasing thickness, and the temperature is basically decreasing in this way. So when we apply the delta sign, this dx becomes positive and the dt becomes negative. So the overall ratio becomes negative. So this temperature gradient would become negative. In order to make it positive, we apply the negative sign in this equation. When the temperature decreases with increasing X, the negative sign ensures that, this negative sign here in this equation ensures that the transfer is in, the heat transfer is in the positive X direction, is actually a positive quantity. This is actually a positive quantity, but the negative sign, this delta T over delta X, is the negative value, and we have to make it positive by putting the negative sign over here. This is the Fourier's law of heat conduction. Let us take an example related to the conduction, or the Fourier's law of heat conduction that we have studied in the previous slide. Let me just read the question statement is, the roof of an electrically heated home, which is 6 meter long and 8 meter wide and 0.25 meter thickness. And the roof has the thermal conductivity is 0.8 watt per meter per degree centigrade, which is given. The temperature of the inner and the outer surfaces of the roof of one night are measured to be 15 degrees centigrade and 4 degrees centigrade respectively for a period of 10 hours. So the inner surface temperature, which is 15 degrees centigrade, is given, and the outer surface temperature is given is 4 degrees centigrade, and the time for which these temperatures are maintained is also given, which is 10 hours. So this is very clear that the inner surface has the 15 degrees centigrade and the outer surface is being at 4 degrees centigrade. So the heat is always travel from higher temperature to the lower temperature. So in this case, the heat will travel from 15 degrees centigrade to 4 degrees centigrade. So what you have to determine is the rate of heat loss through the roof at that night. You have to determine the heat loss, number A. Number B is the cost of that heat loss to the home owner if the cost of electricity is $0.08 per kilowatt hour. So this is the question statement that you have to determine two things, that the what is the rate of heat loss, right? And the second thing is you have to determine the cost for that particular amount of heat loss that is basically lost into the environment during that night. So everything is given. The dimensions of the roofs are also given, and the higher and the lower temperature is also given, and the thermal conductivity of the roof is also given. Now let's move to the solution. Here is the solution of the above mentioned example. So you have to solve that problem. You have to take some assumptions. So one is the steady state operation conditions existing during the night, and since the surface temperatures of the roof remains constant at a specified value, so second assumption is the constant properties can be used for the roof. So the properties which you have in the question statement is the thermal conductivity, that is 0.8 watt per meter per degree centigrade, which is the thermal conductivity of the roof. What you have to do is you have to use the Faraday's law of heat conduction, which is basically over here, right, which is mentioned over here. So what you have to do is everything is given related to this formula, that is thermal conductivity. Yes, it is given. You can calculate the surface area of the roof, that is multiplying by the 6 meter and the 8 meter, multiply by 48 meter square. You have the surface area of the roof, and you have the initial temperature, you have the final temperature, or you can say that you have the inner surface temperature and the outer surface temperature and the length of the roof, which is basically the thickness. After putting all the values, you can calculate the rate of heat transfer, which is 1690 watt. If you divide it by 1000, it will become 1.69 kilowatt, which is basically the answer of first part of this question. So in the part A, you have calculated the rate of heat transfer. So in the second part, first you have to calculate the total amount of heat which is basically lost during the 10 hours, right? So the rate of heat transfer multiplied by the time. So you can calculate it by multiplying at 1.69 kilowatt multiplied by 10 hours. So it will become 16.9 kilowatt hour. This is the total amount of heat which is basically lost during the 10 hours, right? So after calculating the total amount of heat, you have to calculate the cost. So the cost is, the formula is, the cost is equal to the amount of energy which is given in the question statement. The amount of energy which is you have calculated right now in this step. And the second is the unit cost of energy which is given in the question statement. So you, after multiplying it, you can calculate the total amount of cost which is basically lost due to this amount of heat lost into the atmosphere. So the cost to the homeowner, this is the discussion or the final comments. The cost to the homeowner of the heat loss through the roof, that night was $1.35. The total heating bill of the house will be much larger since the heat losses through the walls are not considered in these calculations. So this is the total amount in dollars for one night and only for the one roof. If you have to calculate it for all the walls and for all the rooms present in that house, obviously this cost will be much, much higher. Thermal conductivity. In the Fourier's law of heat conduction, you guys have studied about the thermal conductivity, which is one of the constant, and it is the material dependent property. Now let's talk about thermal conductivity. Thermal conductivity of a material can be defined as the rate of heat transfer through a unit thickness of a material per unit area per unit temperature difference. So what is the ability, and it is basically the ability, thermal conductivity tells us about the ability of a material to conduct the heat through a certain material. So the thermal conductivity of a material is a measure of the ability of a material to conduct the heat. A higher value of thermal conductivity indicates that the material is a good heat conductor, and a low value of thermal conductivity indicates that the material is the poor heat conductor, or simply known as insulator. So here you can see that here is a table. As you can see that air, which has a very small value of thermal conductivity, so it is a poor heat conductor. So glass fiber and the soft rubbers, all these values which are on the lower side of the table has a lower value of thermal conductivity, so it means that they are poor conductors. So the silver, copper and gold, they have the higher value of thermal conductivities. It means that they are the good conductors of heat. This is another table which will give you the idea about the thermal conductivities of various materials at the room temperature. As you can see that the gases has the low value of the thermal conductivity, and the liquids have the higher values, as well as the metal and alloys and the non-metallic crystals have the highest value of thermal conductivities at the room temperature. This chart is basically the comparison of thermal conductivities of different materials which are available, and the thermal conductivities are calculated at room temperature. So we can say that at the end, the metals and the pure metals and the crystals have the higher value of thermal conductivities compared to all other materials. Another material property is the thermal diffusivity. So the material property that appears in transient heat conduction analysis is the thermal diffusivity, which basically explains that how fast the heat diffuses through a certain material. That basically defines that the thermal diffusivity, right? So it is basically the ratio of the heat conducted divided by the heat stored. So the heat conducted can be explained by, can be written with the thermal conductivity K, and the heat stored is written as the ratio of density multiplied by the heat capacity. So the heat capacity, there are two types of the heat capacities. The one is the heat capacity per unit mass, and the second one is the heat capacity per unit volume. You guys can see from the literature that what is the difference between the heat capacity per unit mass as well as the per heat capacity per unit volume. The units are given at the bottom of this slide. You guys can differentiate the difference between these two heat capacities. So the thermal diffusivity again is another property of a material which is basically used in the transient heat conduction. So I will explain in the upcoming slide is what is the transient heat conduction, what is the steady state heat conduction. So these are the topics which I will explain in the upcoming lectures. So this table which basically explains that the thermal diffusivity of different materials. So thermal diffusivity is represented by alpha, and its units are meter square per second. So silver, gold, copper, aluminium, these are the materials which has the higher value of thermal diffusivity, right? So in these materials, the heat conduction is very fast.
Whereas in the materials which are present at the bottom of the table, like water, glass wool and glass and heavy oil, these are the materials through which the heat conduction is very slow. So that's why their thermal diffusivity is very low. So this slide basically explains about the thermal diffusivity. And what is thermal diffusivity? It is basically tells us that how fast the heat diffuses through a material. So this table also tells us the comparison between the different materials, which material has the higher thermal diffusivity and which has the lower thermal diffusivity. And this thermal diffusivity has applications in the transient heat conduction.